few weeks back, a snowstorm hit the Netherlands and rail freight got stuck for at least a week. We'll talk about it with the infrastructure manager. And this is Rail Freight Live. Hello everyone, it's Friday 13 March and in the studio with me is Jessica van den Bos from ProRail. Welcome. What exactly do you do at ProRail?
I'm the director of account management, which means that I'm responsible for the relation with the transportation companies.
Okay, it's very good to have you here. We're going to talk with Jessica in a while, but before we start, we're going to have a look at a short summary because we have talked about this subject before.
Vandaag is de miljoenennota gepresenteerd. Hoe ziet het budget voor het sporen uit?
Nou, we vinden het natuurlijk ontzettend belangrijk om juist in deze periode te investeren. Te investeren in infrastructuur en dus ook te investeren in het spoor. Daarom trekken we voor de komende jaren 1,4 miljard aan middelen naar voren. En de komende twee jaar gaan we al ongeveer de helft van die extra middelen uitgeven. Zodat we snel kunnen investeren in beter beheer en onderhoud en vervanging van alles wat er nodig is van onze spoorinfrastructuur.
We have to have a reliable rail system. So yeah. We do have to do more things about maintenance or renewals or replacing systems. I think we have now about 100 points of malfunctions, and we have to solve those malfunctions. And we have to replace the system on Kai Fook. We have to deal with the regulations for that. We want to have a new fire system for the Waalhaven. So there are a lot of things we want to do and we're doing this moment.
But we have many other topics on the harbour line. Switches which are very old, the railway crossings which are not working properly. As an example, they need to change, I think, already on the Waalhaven. 70 switches, and that will have a lot of problems for us because that can only be done when we are not riding trains and we are a 24/7 operation.
This is a switch you can operate on the spot with this machine. If you operate it right now with the snow between the movable part of the switch and the track, then there's you press the snow into a compact of ice, and because of that, there's no connection between the movable part of the switch and the railroad track and the track itself. So, and then if you drive over it with a locomotive or some cars, then you derail.
The snow crisis situation has now become disproportionate, and it become clear to me that the Dutch railway network only functions at temperatures between 1 and 29 degrees or so. When it snows, it's almost impossible to run a freight train properly. When there is also frost, the chaos is complete.
Structure in general, and of course this reference was made to the snowstorm a few weeks ago. Mm-hmm. He said it was chaos. Was it chaos indeed?
Well, I think after the first 2 days, we could have done really better in starting up the transportation again. So in the first days, there was very extreme weather, powdery snow and heavy winds, and that really crippled down the system. But after that, it took us too long to start up. So what we need is a clear contingency plan to have a faster startup. So my main conclusion is that after the first days of unavoidable disruption, we could have done really better. So we're sorry for the inconvenience.
Yep. Now, you mentioned the contingency plan. We're going to talk about it, but was there any other factor that was causing this delay of starting up, or was it just a lack of plan?
I think for the startup, it was indeed the lack of a clear contingency plan. We are evaluating also at the moment what we need to do to improve for a next time. Next week we will have meetings with the railway transportation companies, because we also want to hear from them what we can do to improve.
Now, there was a lot of talk about the switches. The switches were not functioning. Why was that?
Well, the switches are, as already mentioned, part of the malfunctions we have to fix, Hans referred in the video. And that's part of the Infra on Order program. Mm-hmm. Which we have, was an answer actually to the Crisis Lab report that was published in October, where we stated, where was very clearly stated that we are lagging behind with renewals. So we have to renew a lot of switches. We did that in last year and we will do that in the coming years.
Yeah. So those switches were part of the problem, part of the plan. Does that also mean that you already knew a while ago that these switches would not operate with these extreme winter conditions?
When it comes to the switch heaters, mm-hmm. I think there's two things. First is that they are quite old systems, so we knew that we would be vulnerable, so there were extra snow teams. And second, is that I think that even when they would have functions as they should, that they cannot cope with the really extreme powdery snow, heavy winds combination, the snowstorm.
Yeah. Now, I'm just curious how what went through your head just a few days before that snowstorm happened, because you knew those switches were there, not able to cope with the snow that was coming. What was then your reaction, not only you, but as ProRail? Mm-hmm. Was there a fuss about it? Did you make a plan? Or what was your reaction in advance?
Well, up front, there was a lot of work to check whether everything would function, and of course to have the extra snow teams available. Mm-hmm. But it's really afterwards that we can say it was not enough.
Yeah, but was it possible that you should you have seen it coming?
I think we knew that there would be snow, but maybe. It was not very clear that it would be the powdery snow and the heavy winds together, and that really crippled the system down more than we expected.
Yeah.
But I think that the really gain can be to have a clear contingency plan together also with the stakeholders, so that when such an extreme situation happens and we cannot cope with it, that afterwards we have a we can start up quite fast and efficient. I think we should focus on that together.
Yeah. Is this contingency plan now under construction?
Yes, we will start with it, but as I said, next week we will include the stakeholders, the railway transportation companies, because I also really want to hear from them what they think would be wise in that. But you can imagine that we think about things as that we first need the supplies for the production plans and the energy plans, that we have kind of, that we need to develop a way of prioritizing in starting up the transport as fast as we can.
Yeah, and what are the possibilities? Are there extra lines somewhere, or are there extra capacity somewhere? What should we think of in terms of contingency plan?
I think it's more having a strategic plan on what to do first and what to do then. Focus on the priorities, and also a communication approach, so that we can really include all the stakeholders, not only transportation companies, but also operators or terminals, in how to get the job done together.
Yeah, and that first, and what should be prioritized, it's a crucial element, because I think a lot of criticism from the rail freight industry is that passengers always come first. And in the beginning, all the focus was on passenger traffic. Some operators in the freight industry said, well, there are not that many passengers currently on the network in this corona time. How do you look at that?
Well, we have to, the harbor line is as much as important as the rest of the network. So that's why we really need a plan for the harbor line. And it's not that we would do the, we should do other things first. No, we start. When it stops snowing, when the extreme weather is over, we start at the harbor line also by clearing the switches and making it work again.
Now, the contingency plan is under construction. Now, we have the switches. You already mentioned it. There is a modernization program going on. And some people suggested that there are winter switches available, that they would be produced by the TU Delft, which is a switch that would be perfectly capable of dealing with these situations. I don't know if this is correct. What do you think?
Well, in 2014, we investigated this type of switch, and back then it didn't meet up with the requirements of the technical requirements, the safety requirements. But we will investigate it again.
Yeah.
Let's see. Maybe it is changed in the meantime. Besides that, I think we have to really think whether, well, it would take a lot of funds to change all the switches to another type. And that's then only for a couple of days a year that we have an extreme snow situation. But we're facing also climate change in the coming decades in the Netherlands. And it will lead to heavy rainfall, heavy winds, droughts, soil instability. And we also need the funds for that.
Yeah. Is this something you've already decided on, or is there room for new approaches?
I think we have to, we're researching that now and see what it all takes. And after that, decisions will be made.
Yeah. Let's imagine that the switch is now meeting the requirements, that winter switch from TU Delft, and it could work. Would you apply it? How high are those chances?
I cannot say. That would be, I think we first have to look at it and investigate, and then make a business case of what it costs and what the benefits will be for the system, and then decide.
Yeah. There's always a lot of criticism during winter on the Netherlands, and people say that, okay, in Switzerland they're able to deal with the winter, in Germany they're able to deal with the winter, and the Netherlands is not. How do you look at that criticism?
Well, I haven't investigated the situation in Germany and Switzerland in last February, but I think we have to look at our own situation and context and see what we can do better. So we talked about the contingency plan. I think that's something we have to focus on, because that's where we can improve.
And the harbor line, it's the biggest harbor in Europe, and everybody is talking about the port of Rotterdam in such a situation. Doesn't it require priority?
It requires priority.
Yeah.
Yes.
And that's because...
We will give it the priority that that's needed.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, because it comes back every time in the news when there is a small element. It's not only winter or snow, it's also wind, for example. Then it is unable to cope with those winter conditions. So is that something, do you think, will change after this modernization plan?
Yeah, for sure. But we said we need 3 years, and we started last year. So we also need some patience before everything is up to standards. But we're very committed to bring it all up to standards as soon as possible.
There's one last thing, the Waalhaven, of course. It was announced that in April it would be open for dangerous goods. Right now it's not possible to shunt dangerous goods there. Is this still on schedule?
Yes, we are on course, but we still have to pass an exam. And the requirements are very strict. But we're very committed to get it done before the 1st of April, because we know how important it is for the railway freight sector in Rotterdam.
Yeah. And if that exam is not passed, what would be then the next deadline?
I think we will have to work very hard and do everything we can. So I would say as soon as possible.
When is the exam?
It's in the last week of March, I think.
Okay. And if that is passed, then by the 1st of April, it will be opened for dangerous goods. Okay,
yes.
Let's hope for the best. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
On the 31st of March and the 1st and 2nd of April, Rail Tech Europe is taking place. Now, this event is one of the largest industry events in Europe, and it's organized from these studios. It's organized from this studio and some of the other studios we have in this building. And on the line with us, we have Arie van Dijk, the CEO of ProMedia Group. Arie, welcome.
Hi, good afternoon.
Nice to have you. Can you tell us a little bit more about this event?
Yes, of course. I'm glad to tell you more. So RailTech is, of course, a big exhibition, European event, in which we are talking about all kinds of developments in the rail industry. Usually every 2 years we come together in the Jaarbeurs in Utrecht, and a lot of exhibitors, they show their products, and it's really an infrastructural party. All the parties are there and you can meet everybody. Of course, due to the pandemic, it's not possible to meet, but we've got an alternative. Well, you are sitting in our studio and you know what we are up to at these days. And well, we now see a lot of potential in our online events because of course, everybody wants to meet each other face to face, but online offers a lot of opportunities too, because you don't have any travel limitations, and it's easy to participate for everybody around the world.
Yep.
So RailTech will take place completely online on the 30th, the 31st and the 1st of April, so at the end of this month, like you said earlier. And now we're going to totally focus on rail with everybody from around the world. So it's still RailTech Europe, but we already got participants from more than 80 different countries, and that's well around the globe.
Yeah. And what is in it for freight? Are there any freight topics on the agenda?
Yes, because like you were discussing with your previous guest, a lot of the tech issues concern freight also. So we've got, it's a 3-day event. And there are 3 different stages. So there's like 9 conference days in total. So there's a lot of content, and it's going to be a lot about all kind of different topics. But freight for sure is a big part of that. So we've got 3 different stages. Like I said, we've got the main stage with all the big policy issues. We've got the ProRail stage, represented by your guest. And the 3rd stage is all about tech. So these are 3 topics. So the main stage, the ProRail stage, and the tech stage. And on all the different stages, there are all kind of different topics. But for instance, on the ProRail stage, there will be 1 session about the Harbour Line and about train detection systems. They're going to change that. And yeah, we get some real good insights in how they change that and what impact that has. So it's quite interesting to see also because, of course, especially in the harbour, there's a lot of there's a lot of discussion also about Rolf ProRail and what's happening. So I think it's very interesting to get some insights in what they're working on. And of course, some parts of the rail infrastructure there are quite young. You were talking about sand on the rails. So it's quite interesting to hear more about that. But also in the tech stage, we've got a lot of topics which are quite interesting for freight as well, like digital automatic coupling, which increases the capacity of the rail network, which is quite interesting. And also on the main stage, in the 1st day, we've got a lot of attention for, of course, the general topic, Year of Rail. And we're going to learn more about the TNT corridor, North Sea Baltic region. What does that mean for model shifts? And quite interesting if you're up to freight to join RailTech and to make your own program and choose out of the more than 100 sessions.
Yeah. And what do people need to do if they want to attend?
Well, go to the website, RailTech Live, and register. And then you get into our platform. And it's more than just like we're talking about content now, but a big part of real tech life is the networking. So we are using a network tool that's called Brella, and you can meet other parties one-on-one. And we really encourage everybody to do so. More than 80 different countries represented, like I said earlier. So I think it's, especially in a time of pandemic, still interesting to build your network. And everybody who's in the platform, we expect over 10,000 guests. We're like halfway there right now. You can really meet everybody who's into this business.
Okay. Well, you already mentioned it. The North Sea Baltic Corridor is one of the topics. And we have Catherine Troutman as a speaker. She's the European coordinator. A while ago, she was interviewed by Marieke van Gomp on Spoor Pro TV. And we're going to show you an interview with her.
Ms. Troutman, you are the coordinator of the North Sea Baltic TEN-T corridor since 2014. How did you become a coordinator?
I was called because of my competence and experience in the urban transport system with the Tramway of Strasbourg, but also my work on the European level on the high-speed train, which crossed France, Germany, and go to Hungary. And also because of my experience being president of the Port of Strasbourg, so I know passenger aspects, but also freight questions and problems. And I was and had the honor to be the Mrs. Rail in 2019 because also of my work to support the operation of the Shift to Rail.
And you also won the European Railway Award some years ago.
Yeah. So this is an obligation too. to continue to support in these years the transition to a more sustainable and reliable transport system with rail.
And in December 2013, 9 major corridors were determined as the backbone of the European transport network. And how has the rail network evolved in the last years?
For the North Sea Baltic network, which is a transversal one from east to west, the main challenge is to have a continuity of a good rail system and to have, to resolve the gap for the high-speed train in the Baltic states with the Rail Baltica. So this is an opportunity. And from these years, the regulation of the TEN-T network was very useful, and we hope that we will finish in 2030 with the all the projects of the corridor.
And one of the most important projects is Rail Baltica. It's a new railway infrastructure with a standard European gauge rail that will open in 2026. What impact do you expect this project will have on the corridor?
This project is the biggest and the most important in technical aspects and also in an era which was not concerned by a high-speed line. So this is really important because this Rail Baltica will connect the western part to the eastern part of the European era and space. And also because it will have a dual use for freight and for passengers. And this is a new opportunity, and it is conceived and one unique project between the three countries, the Baltic countries, and it will link Finland to Poland and Germany and, of course, Netherlands and Belgium.
And does the coronavirus have any impact on the progress of the project?
Yes, we have some months which were taken, unfortunately, for the teams working on the project. For example, the Spanish team for technical design. So this is a pity, and but we could have also a sort of demonstration also in this corridor with the sanitary trains that the rail is very useful, not only for to obtain good results for the targets of the climate change, but also for this, if I can say, sanitarian, interest, which was really, really important.
And why are these kind of projects important for the shift to rail to be realized?
It is important because, of course, in these countries, in the west, eastern and northern countries, the climate change is especially present, and we see it with more humid zones. But we see also that we have, with the long distances trains, the necessity to have performance on rail freight. So this is for the connection. Solving the questions and the problems in the urban nodes, having new terminals to operate shift to rail, but also having the capacity to solve the bottlenecks is the main challenges in the corridor. And we work very closely with the member states, with professionals, and with all the partners, and especially, of course, the rail companies.
And what are the main bottlenecks at the moment?
The main bottlenecks, if I can say, are connected to the lack of ERTMS. For example, in Warsaw and Berlin, we need to have, progress in this signalization and intelligence systems. But we have also bottlenecks on the line of the network, and sometimes it's a problem to use long trains of 740 meters. And this is a problem for the business aspect. But this is also the lack of terminals and especially rail lines in urban nodes. And this will be the top priority of the next work in the corridor.
So what are the projects that are specifically focusing on this?
We work with my colleague, coordinator for ERTMS, to resolve the ERTMS gap. This will be especially the case with new projects. It's feasible with the Rail Baltica to make the installation of ERTMS on the line. So this is a big progress, but we need to solve this interconnection aspect. But we have also other technical aspects and also administrative burdens. Now the customers, they want to know where the goods are, when they will arrive, and these bottlenecks create problems of time used for the transport. So we hope that digitalization and innovative systems for this knowledge of all the tracing of goods for the customers will be a big progress. So these are the points on which we want to work specifically.
And Rail Baltica is also a combined digitalization project.
Yes, so this is easier when you have a new project as the Rail Baltica to combine all the innovative solutions at the beginning. But we have also the participation of many member states and stakeholders. For example, we prepare a working group on hydrogen solutions, and we have many innovative projects in different member states. And this is a pleasure for me because we supported in the Netherlands nitrogen bus, and this was a sort of departure. Then we looked on the hydrogen trains, and this was a very good cooperation. And we hope that we will have for alternative fuels some also good perspectives. And that, rail will be perceived not as an old system, but as a new system. And this is very important for new professionals to understand that they have their place and that rail is attractive for professionals.
And this year is the European Year of Rail, and it is highlighted to make it more attractive for passengers, also for moving goods. Why do you think it's important?
It is important to show what rail is able to offer for the perception and good knowledge of the benefits. And these benefits are very important because rail is performant, but also a very compatible system of transport for the climate change and for resilient system and sustainable systems. So we hope that this perception will be really understood by the population. And also, this is a moment of mobilization of all the rail family to make the exchange and knowledge of all the innovation, but also to show the social benefits of rail. And this will be the occasion. This year for rail is, and for rail freight especially, is a very, very good moment for all these challenges.
And what do you expect that this year will bring?
And with that, we've come to an end of this week's Rail Freight Live. Now, don't forget to subscribe so you can receive our notifications. And for now, see you next week. Goodbye.
En ook u kunt hier zitten, want deze coronaproof studio is te huur voor uw congres, vergadering of webinar. We hebben alle techniek in huis om u hierbij te helpen. Kijk voor meer informatie op promedia.nl. Ik zie u graag in onze studio.